How's it going? As a lot of you guys know, I've been on a little bit of a LEAPS bender recently. It's all I can talk about or think about. I love them. I'd marry them if I could, but I can't. Although I haven't checked. Yeah, no, I can't. And while LEAPS are great, some of you guys have brought up the concern that they're not great for everybody because some people straight up can't afford them. All right, a LEAPS on Microsoft or Apple might be $3,000, $4,000, or $5,000. And some people might be able to afford them, but it would still result in an over allocation of funds to LEAPS in your portfolio and it'd throw the whole portfolio out of whack. You have too much leverage. So I'm here, your knight in shining armor, to give you a few solutions to this problem if you're having this problem. If you can't afford LEAPS, but want to participate. Solution number one, which may not sound like a solution, but it's something to consider, okay? And that is, don't buy LEAPS. If you can't afford LEAPS, maybe now is a good time to just start building up your nest egg, all right? Adding money to long-term investments, and then when you can afford LEAPS, go for it and use that as your form of leverage. At which point, once you have your nice nest egg going, you're not gonna be worried about success or failure because you have so much money already accruing compounding interest. And really, long-term investing is underappreciated in our sphere, it feels like, amongst the people you and I hang out with, which is each other. Okay, that's one option, but I'm assuming that because you're here, you're looking for leverage, you want to use LEAPS, but maybe can't and just don't know what to do, and just solely long-term investing is not your cup of tea, and that is totally fine. Then the second thing to consider is raising your strike, so maybe it has a lower delta than a 0.7 through 0.9 delta, will raise your break even, yes. It will reduce your probability of success, yes. But if you don't raise it by that much, and it puts you in the realm of being able to afford it, then maybe it's not such a bad idea. Raising your strike and lowering your delta to around maybe 0.65 or 0.6 is going to reduce your success. It's going to increase your theta. It's going to raise your break even. The stock price is going to have to go further up as time goes on for you to reach your break even. So it just has a lower probability of success. But if you have a very bullish outlook on a stock, you think you bought a really juicy dip, maybe it's worth justifying a raise in strike, a reduction in delta, a raise in break even for that reduction in buying power that allows you to afford it. In this case, especially in this case, do not over allocate to these call options. At this point, you're just buying call options. A 0.65 and a 0.6 delta will still have a pretty high probability of success. I just prefer, if I can, to put, you know, stack all the odds in my favor, which means nice and deep in the money, nice and low break even, a lot of time till expiration. And on that same vein, you could also shorten up the time until expiration to make it cheaper, but then you're also going to be running, trying to beat the buzzer a little bit more. And if it's under a year and you sell for a profit, you're going to be taxed at the short-term capital gains tax rate, which is higher than the long-term capital gains tax rate, which you would get if you sold for a profit after holding a position for a year in a day or more. Okay, so those are the first two, but really the main solution that I'm going to offer you today is this third one, and that is, try debit call spread. What's a debit call spread, you might ask? Well, I'm not gonna treat today as a debit call spread tutorial entirely, although by the end of today, even if you know nothing about it, you'll be able to go out there and trade these. So you should watch the tutorial up in the corner, even though it's a little bit dusty and old. I think it's still pretty solid to give you more insight into the minute characteristics of debit spreads. Wait, I feel like I've been talking like I was gonna finish this sentence, but I don't remember how the sentence began. Debit call spreads are buying a long call option and then selling a call option against it, which results in a lower break even because you're gonna receive a credit, which is gonna reduce the cost of the trade, which reduces your break even when you're reducing a cost of a trade. And it's gonna reduce the amount of buying power needed because when you buy a long call, it's a debit, you're paying money out the door, but when you sell to open a call option, it's money coming back in. So overall, you're gonna have a buying power reduction. So they're gonna be cheaper. But the same idea of like a LEAPS outlook applies. With a debit call spread, you're hoping the stock's gonna go up. That's the goal across time. While your profit and loss is gonna be different than a LEAPS, the same idea applies. You're still bullish on the underlying. Well, why wouldn't everybody trade this if you have a reduction in buying power? Well, a few reasons. Number one, your potential profits are going to be capped. By buying a long call and then selling a short call against it, as the stock price rises and as it pushes your entire spread, your debit call spread in the money, your long leg's gonna be making money, but your short leg is gonna be losing money. For quite a while, your long leg's gonna be making more money than your short leg is losing, but after a certain point, their deltas, as they get very deep in the money, or deeper in the money, they become so similar that they negate each other. So you're going to hit a max potential profit. On the plus side, this works in reverse, where if things start going against you and push your spread out of the money, your downside is going to be limited as well, significantly more than if you had just bought a call option outright. So it's going to reduce your max profit, but it's also going to reduce your max losses as well. So it's just going to shrink the stock range within you will make or lose money. So that's kind of a downside, because that means, like, across time, if you're trading a debit call spread and the stock price rises and you hit your max profit, well, it's time to sell. Like, you hit your max profit, and that could be under a year. And if it's under a year and you sell for a profit, you're going to be taxed at the short-term capital gains tax rate, which is not preferable. With a LEAPS, you can hold indefinitely because it's a call option with undefined upside potential. So if the stock keeps going, you're going to keep making money. You can definitely hold that longer than a year, as long as it remains liquid, or if you can exercise by expiration. So that's the downside, you know, limited upside potential, which also means you're probably gonna have to liquidate your position earlier, which means you might be taxed at a higher tax rate, but still you're probably, you know, you have a chance of making more money through these debit spreads than you do with just going with long-term investments, even if you're gonna be taxed at a higher rate. Okay, so that's kind of the broad picture scope of what we're talking about here. Let's zoom in a little bit and look at an example so you can start seeing how this concretely all ties together. All right, we're going to optimistprofitcalculator.com. We're going to open the spread on Microsoft. Maybe we want to open a LEAPS on Microsoft, but we can't afford it. And we're like, whoa, I watched that really super dope video in The Money Made about debit call spreads. I'm going to try one of those. So you decide to do it on Microsoft. The first leg we're going to do is our long leg, the call option we're going to buy. You should be very familiar with this if you've traded options whatsoever. We're going to select option. We're going to go out to about a year, okay, so that if things take a while to go up and we don't have to liquidate our position, if it doesn't hit our max profit, then we can hold for longer than a year and we can be taxed at the long-term capital gains tax rate. I've never actually ended up in that situation before. However, it is possible. I don't think I've ever held a debit call spread that long. You do not have to, for this long leg, buy it so deep in the money. With LEAPS, you know, 0.7, 0.9 delta is what people say. That just, you know, gives you a place to start where you'll have a nice low break even and low theta. You don't have to do it so low with such a low strike with debit call spreads, because when you sell that short leg against it, that credit you receive from that is going to reduce your break even. So you don't have to go so deep in the money, and you wouldn't want to either, because liquidity is especially important with debit call spreads because you're dealing with two legs. If you have a LEAPS and maybe you buy it and then down the road it gets very deep in the money, you want to sell it for a profit, maybe the bid ask is widened by 4 points. Okay, it's 4 points wide. You go to sell that that call option, you have to give up maybe $1 in premium to get out of the trade. You have to sell 1 point closer to the bid price. So you give up $100. Well, that's just with one leg. If you have two legs and you have to give up some money in the bid ask of both of those options, like you would with a debit call spread, then you could be potentially doubling the amount of money you're spending to get out of the trade. So liquidity is more important with multi-leg spreads, which includes debit call spreads. So that's another reason you don't want to buy a long call that's so deep in the money, because the deeper in the money you get, the less liquid those options are, especially as over time the stock price rises, pushing your spread even deeper in the money. So you wouldn't want to buy deep in the money for that reason, and you don't have to anyway, because your short leg reduces your break even so significantly. Personally, if you're trying to emulate LEAPS, I would probably start around a 0.6 delta on a nice liquid underlying. Popular stock, popular options, a lot of volume and open interest and tight bid asks. So let's pop over to Thinkorswim to see what has a 0.6 delta. We're on Microsoft June 17th, 2022 expiration. And if we go to the delta column, let me make this bigger so Eric doesn't kill me. So we go to the delta column, we follow it down to around a 0.6 delta, follow it over, it's a 240 strike. Great, so we go to the June 17th, 2022 expiration here. We go to the 240 strike and we click on the mid price. If we wanna be more conservative, we can click on the ask price, but mid would be fine. Really quick, I wanna come back over to Thinkorswim here to show you that Microsoft is super liquid. If we look at the open interest, which is this column, even though it cuts off there, you can see there's tons of open interest. And if we go to the bid ask spread, even if we get super, super deep in the money to a 135 strike, the bid ask is still only like $1.10 wide, $1.15. So this underlying is very liquid, and it'll get more liquid the closer to expiration it gets. And this expiration is over a year out. Okay, so we've done our long call option. Well, what would this look like if we just ran with this one? It would look like this. The entry cost would be about $3,300, a little under, because the cost of the call option. You can see the stock price would have to rise in order for us to break even by expiration, and that is that decay of extrinsic value. When you buy a call option, it has time value built into it, and as time passes, that portion of premium decays so that the stock price must rise So you start building up some intrinsic value to make up for the loss of that extrinsic value. So the stock price has to rise for you to break even. Does it have to rise by that much? Not really, you know, probably 6-7% it looks like. But the cost of the trade might be too much for you. $3,000, not really worth it if you, you know, all you have is $3,000, because you can lose everything in one trade. So let's go ahead and sell a call option against this one. So we're gonna go to our second leg. We're gonna switch this to right. We're writing a call option. We're creating an entirely new one and selling it to somebody. Choose the same expiration, June 17th, 2022. And you get to pick the call option you write. It's whatever you want. The further out of the money the call option is that you write, the more expensive the trade is going to be, the larger your max loss, but also the larger potential profit. So really, you want to manipulate the short leg to make the overall trade the cost you want it to be. So for example, the leg we bought is like $3,300. If I go over here and I sell the 300 strike call option for $1,000, that's going to reduce the cost of this overall trade from $3,300 to $2,300, right? Because when we buy our long call, it's a debit. Money's going out the door, $3,300 out the door. And then we sell a call option, it's a credit. We have another grand coming in the door. So $3,300 out, $1,000 in, that means it overall costs $2,300. And with debit spreads, that is the max that you're risking, is the debit for the trade. So you want to manipulate it so that what you're risking, the debit for the trade, is appropriate for your portfolio. You also want to consider that the further out of the money the short strike is, the more you could potentially make. So as you increase the risk of the overall trade, you're also increasing the potential profit. So manipulate this so that it fits right into your portfolio, all snug as a rug, and makes sense for you. And I would always straddle at the money, okay? I wouldn't sell an in the money call option. It's just not gonna give you as preferable statistics, IMO. So if this one's $3,300, maybe we only wanna pay $2,000 for this overall trade in Microsoft, then we wanna sell an option that's about $1,300. So we could sell the 290 strike at the mid price, and we'll hit calculate. All right, look, now the cost of the trade is $2,000, which is the max risk for the trade. We can see our max return right there. It's about $3,000. Our break-even at expiry is 260.30. What is Microsoft's current stock price? It's 252. Well, if you look at that and you're like, that still seems a little bit too high for me, you wanna lower the break-even, then what you should do is you take your short strike and you lower it, because break-even is equal to your long strike plus the debit of the trade. So if you manipulate the debit of the trade so it's smaller, but keep the same long strike, then you're gonna reduce your break-even price. So you can even have it that the stock price goes down a little bit and you'll still make money by expiration. In this case, that is not the case. And if you want that to be the case, just lower your short strike. It'll lower the overall risk for the trade and it will lower the break-even for the trade as well. And you also wanna keep in mind that your short strike is where you're expecting the stock price to go by expiration if you wanna hit max profit. So in this case, our short strike is 290. And if we go to around 290 over here on the left side, you know, somewhere between 286 and 299, and we follow that all the way over to expiration, we're gonna be at our max profit by expiration at our short strike. So that's something to keep in mind as well. Also notice though, that when we first start out on the first day of this trade, if it pops right up to 299, we are not at our max profit. We get to our max profit across time as theta starts taking effect, because the theta of our short leg is going to be higher than the theta of our long leg. On the very first day, the stock price has to go much higher than your short leg in order for you to hit your max profit. It would have to go above $500. But as time passes, when your short leg is closer to being at the money, and in this case it would be if we're at 299 because our short leg is 290, it's closer to at the money. When our short leg is closer at the money, as time passes, we are going to be making money. That is because at the money options have the highest extrinsic value, which is the portion of premium that has to decay off by expiration, which means that they're going to have the highest theta, which means that our short legs theta is larger than our long legs theta. And our short legs theta benefits us. As that option decays in value, we could buy to close it for a cheaper price. It has a positive theta. It works in our favor, the exact opposite as a long call's negative theta. So when that positive theta is larger than our long call's negative theta, we're making money as each day passes. And that is what is happening when our short leg is closer to being at the money. And as time goes on, we will make money. And if we stay at or above our short strike by expiration, we're gonna hit our max profit of about $3,000. The exact opposite is true down here when our long leg is closer to at the money. That means our long leg's negative theta is larger than our short leg's positive theta. Theta is now an enemy of this trade. And as time goes on, we're gonna lose money until at expiration, we're gonna be at our max loss if we are at or below our long leg strike. So this is a good way to imitate leaps in the sense that you have such a high probability of success. Break even is very low, and you can make it even lower than this by reducing the strike of your short leg. So our break even is very, very low. We're still long on the stock, and we've given ourselves some leverage. This would not have as much leverage if we spent $2,000 on just shares instead of using this debit spread. But it is still, in my opinion, not as preferable as leaps are for a couple reasons. Number one, as you get deeper in the money, your leverage shrinks. See, if I go from 364 to 377, we make a little over $100. Now, if I pop all the way up here from 468 to 481, we make like 15 bucks. So as your spread starts winning, as it starts getting more and more in the money, your leverage starts going down. That means that each additional dollar profit becomes harder and harder to collect, which kind of makes it a good idea to probably close this trade at around a 75% profit, which means you're probably going to be closing this under a year, which means you're going to be taxed at short-term capital gains tax rate, and you're going to have to open a new spread, which is fine. You know, you're still making money, right? But that's one reason why leaps are preferable, is that you can hold it for longer than a year and get preferable tax treatment. And with leaps, as they get deeper and deeper in the money, the delta keeps increasing up to a point. You know, it increases very quickly at first and then slows down through gamma. But your delta increases the deeper in the money you get. You start getting more leverage as the trade starts going in your favor, and less leverage if this trade starts going against you. That's one benefit of leaps. Another benefit is that you can hold for longer than a year, like I just mentioned. And another benefit is that liquidity is not as big of an issue because, number one, you're dealing with one leg, so you're not giving as much up in the bid ask because you're not dealing with two separate options that you're trying to open or close. And number two, you can always exercise the call option because it has a small amount of extrinsic value, particularly if you've held it all the way to expiration or very, very close. Leaps are also better because they have uncapped profits, right? The stock price could go up forever and you can keep on making money. With this one, that's not the case. Your profits are capped and it becomes harder and harder to reach your max profit through the delta of your options as the trade starts going in your favor. The benefit is, though, across time, your trade will improve if your short leg is closer to at the money, which happens when the stock price has risen a little bit. Still, even with those downsides, this is a perfectly acceptable way of leveraging your portfolio. I would still definitely not over allocate to this strategy. I would just use it similar to as if you were using leaps. So this is a great substitute if you can't afford leaps and you're just trying to build up enough capital to the point where you can afford leaps, because leaps are much more easier to manage, you know, and they have those benefits that we just discussed. Now, one more thing we have to talk about with debit spreads is assignment. At any point when you sell to open an option, when you write an option, you are exposing yourself to assignment risk, the risk that that option becomes in the money and your counterparty exercises. What happens in assignment varies depending on what strategy you're utilizing, and we are just going to explicitly talk about debit call spreads today. Now, I'm doing it on optionsprofitcalculator.com because it's easier to like drag my mouse over and point at stuff. But you can use Options Profit Calculator, the app, on your mobile device. You can use it on your phone. They also have an iPad app for it that isn't just like a mini phone version for your iPad. It actually takes up your full screen. And it's like this, except for it's more smooth. It looks better. You're able to manipulate implied volatility easier, and you get to carry it around in your pocket. So I highly encourage you to check it out. You can find the link to that app in the description below. There are two time periods in which your short leg can get assigned. If the stock price, for example, jumps up to 300, this short leg is in the money. Your counterparty may exercise it at any time. The deeper in the money it is and the closer to expiration it is, the higher the chance of being assigned, of your counterparty exercising. And also, if there's a dividend coming up, that can also play in. We'll talk about that in a second as well. So before expiration, if your short leg becomes in the money, which means your whole spread is in the money because your long leg has a lower strike than your short one, then you can get assigned, and here's what happens. When your counterparty exercises your short leg, they're going to buy 100 shares at the strike of 260, which means you have to sell 100 shares at the strike of 260 to them. When they buy that call option from you, they have the right but not the obligation to exercise that contract. You as a counterparty, you have the obligation to fulfill that right if they do choose to exercise that call option. So before expiration, if your counterparty exercises, you're going to end up with a short position. If you do not already own 100 shares of the underlying stock, you're going to end up with a short position of minus 100 shares. You're also still going to have your long call. And in this case, what you're going to do is you're just going to close both of these positions. Just close them. It might look really scary at first. There might be wild changes to your buying power and a bunch of big numbers being thrown around. But all you have to do in this situation is buy to close your 100 shares and simultaneously sell to close the call option. The overall result will actually benefit you. You will make a profit from assignment with debit spreads. You wouldn't want to exercise your call option in this scenario because you're going to give up extrinsic value by doing so, unless there's enough upcoming dividend that's larger than the value of the extrinsic value of your call option. But generally, if someone's exercising, if your counterparty is exercising on you due to maybe lack of liquidity, maybe they'd give up less through deleting extrinsic value than they would by trying to sell with a wide bid ask, then you just close your short stock position, close your long call position, and you're going to end with a gain with debit spreads. At expiration, if you get assigned, you're going to result in a short stock position of minus 100 shares. And you're gonna still have your long call, but your brokerage is gonna automatically exercise that. So you're gonna buy 100 shares. And this will happen after hours, after close on expiration. This will result in a flat position, a neutral position, zero shares open. You're gonna be completely closed out of the position, and you're gonna have your max profit. So this is also good for you. You're gonna make money through assignment at expiration as well. Now, a couple things to note. Number one is if the stock price is trading anywhere close to the strikes of your options at expiration, just close it before expiration, no matter what. If the stock price is hovering around these strikes right here, something that can happen is that your counterparty at expiration initially decides to exercise, and your brokerage starts the process of exercising your call option to counteract or mitigate that assignment risk. However, maybe after hours, the stock price drops and pushes your short leg out of the money. Well, then your counterparty might cancel their exercise request, but your brokerage doesn't see that. They're going to still exercise your long call option. What can happen on monthly expirations, which are Fridays, is that your short option actually expires worthless, but your long call option still gets exercised. So you end up with 100 shares in your portfolio that you hold over the weekend. And whatever, you know, if it gaps up or gaps down, you're going to incur those losses or gains with 100 shares in your portfolio. So that could be a lot of leverage you don't want to deal with. That is called pin risk. And I'll put a video to that exact topic up in the corner. Another thing to note is that if an upcoming dividend is larger than the extrinsic value of an option, your counterparty is probably going to exercise. Why? Well, when you exercise a call option, yes, you give up extrinsic value. You only extract intrinsic value. But if you can get 100 shares in your portfolio and collect an upcoming dividend that is greater than the extrinsic value you deleted through exercising, then why wouldn't you do that? You would do that. And for that reason, you will get assigned if an upcoming dividend is larger than the extrinsic value of the option, because they'll collect it through the dividend. They'll make up for the loss of extrinsic value and then some through that upcoming dividend. Okay, and lastly, let's go ahead and just run through an example of actually trading this this type of strategy. So to simulate this trade, we are going to use Thinkorswim's on-demand feature. Basically, throws us in the time machine and shoots us back in the past so we can trade in the past. It's actually a really great way to practice or to toy around. If you ever need to reset your on-demand thing, go to the top right, hit reset account, bam. All right, so we're on January 2nd, 2020, way back when. So let's say we want to open a debit call spread on January 21st, 2022, about a year out. Okay, we're going to open our long leg at around a 0.6 delta. Okay, you could do a little bit, maybe a little bit more in the money if you want to reduce the break even. I would open it somewhere in a 0.6 delta. We'll start with a 0.65. So we'll open it, our long leg, with a 145 strike. So what we do on Thinkorswim anyway is we right click on anywhere on the row of our 145 strike. We do buy and vertical, because this is a vertical spread. It's a debit call spread. It's called a bull call spread. It's also called a vertical call spread. We're going to open our short call option out of the money. You know, again, this depends on how low your break-even you want your break-even to be. Use the options profit calculator app to help determine where your break-even is going to be and what your profit potential is and max loss is without having to do all the calculations yourself, etc. But I know this call option is about $3,000. Maybe I want to just put $2,000 in the trade. So I want to sell a call option that's about worth $1,000, which would be the 185 strike. So we can move this to 185. Okay, now that we have this set up, we want to make sure that everything looks right. We want it as a limit order. We can set it for good till canceled if we want the limit order to stay pending for longer than a day. I don't. I'll just wait for it to get filled today. And we'll start at the mid price. We're going to immediately get filled at the mid price. But realistically, you would start at the mid price. And if you don't get a fill after a couple minutes, move it up by a penny in premium. And then wait to see if you get a fill, and then cancel, replace, move it up by a penny again. Start moving it closer and closer and closer to the asking price. And at some point between the mid and the asking price, you're going to get a fill. When you're selling, you're going to want to sell between the mid and the bid price. So we'll start with the mid, hit confirm and send this off. There we go. We go to our monitor tab, and there's our Microsoft spread right here. We have a long call and a short call. We are not concerned, when we look at the profit and loss open, we're not concerned about the individual profit and loss of each of these options. We're concerned about the profit and loss overall. The individual profit and loss for each of these options is going to be very, very large, but we're concerned about the net profit and loss between the two. If at any point you decide, you know, maybe the stock price is really ripping and you can afford to buy to close your short leg, you can do that. Buy to close your short leg, let your long call option rip, and then sell that one for a profit. It's not a bad strategy, although if you can't afford leaps, maybe that might not work super well for you. I don't know. Depends on the scenario. Okay. Let's fast forward a little bit and just see how it performs. All right. Let's go forward to August 2020, end of the month. Okay. So we bought somewhere around here and we held all the way up to there through the whole coronavirus crash and all that. We've made a 57% profit while Microsoft made a roughly 34% profit. So you can see it's significantly less leverage than a LEAPS, obviously, because you're selling a call against it, which is the opposite of buying a call. It's going to negate the delta of your long call. But we still made more money than if we had just bought shares. And if we unfurl this, we can see that the profit of our long call is pretty dang high, and the loss of our short call is pretty dang high as well. If we had just held this long call, we would have made money. So it's entirely possible to just raise your strike and that's it, to reduce the cost of your trade and still make money. It just depends over what time period you do it. It's possible that a stock trades sideways for a year and a half and you don't make money. I prefer to put the odds in my favor. Maybe I reduce my leverage, you know, somewhat and I miss out on potential gains, but I've put the odds in my favor so I don't have to worry about it. Okay, maybe 60% profit. It's looking pretty good. We want to close the trade. We don't have to close each leg individually here. We can just right click, hit create closing order, sell one vertical, and we'll sell it at the mid price, hit confirm and send. There we go, we sold it. So there you go. That's how you can increase leverage without having to fork up a ton of money. It's a great alternative to LEAPS, but I still highly encourage people to dabble in LEAPS in the future once they build up their nest egg. LEAPS are great because they have, you know, unlimited profit potential, because you're not forced to sell within a year and realize gains at a short-term capital gains rate, and because you don't have to worry about liquidity so much. But that said, if you'd have to overallocate funds to LEAPS to make it happen, don't. This is a perfectly acceptable alternative. And if this is too much for you, don't. Just go buy long-term investments until you can do LEAPS, or you can just stick with long-term investments. It doesn't matter how you make your money as long as you're making money. Thanks for watching. If you want to follow my LEAPS heavy portfolio, you can follow it on Iris down below. Deposit $100 into Webull. You can get up to, I think, $1,400 in free stocks. There's other free stock stuff down there. Check out Pins by Charlie. Check out Options Profit Calculator. All that stuff down there that I desperately want you to go put your little peepers on. Go take a look. As always, thanks for watching and best of luck. Have a fantastic week. I love you.